Let's get into another discipline, a new world championship discipline, the esports world championships, which will be broadcast live and on demand on Flow Bike for viewers in the US and Canada on December 9th.
And I must admit, I was doing a bit of research to find out what was going on here, the what they're racing. So all these guys are coming together, 50 kilometers, 480 meters of climbing on this course, Watopia. Not big climbs, but looks like some tough stuff up out there. We got a few of these cross guys, like Pidcock himself, racing on, is it December 9th on a Wednesday, right? So those guys are going to be out there racing, and should be quite interesting because the winner virtually gets a rainbow jersey at the end of this that they can win the wear and all these other events coming up.
Yeah, it's super cool. I mean, as somebody who's pretty far down on the Zwift levels, I'm like a level 12 and have to embarrassingly wear like the super basic like checker jersey that's available for you. Wearing that World Championships avatar jersey, it will be really neat. And I think something new and cool for the sport, a different element. They will also get a physical jersey that they can wear while they're riding the trainer competing in virtual events. And this course is interesting too. I actually did a recon ride of this course with Lawson Craddock. We'll play that video at the end of the show here.
And Lawson's on the start list as well. We saw him in there.
Yeah, Lawson Racing for Team USA, a very accomplished Zwifter. And it's a long-ish race, I guess, 50 kilometers, you know, take the riders just over an hour to complete, which is, if you've ever competed in a virtual race, 20 minutes is a long time to compete in a virtual race. So it'll be interesting to see how an hour plus long virtual race plays out. And then, just a lumpy course, no big climbs, but a lot of sort of harder power climbs in that sort of 2 minute range. So I am anticipating a small group sprint finish at the end, but you also never really know on the Zwift platform. Let's get into some of the favorites. Let's start with the women. The names that stuck out to me right away are the two best women in the world, Anna van der Breggen and Annemiek van Vleuten, who will be competing for the Dutch team.
Yeah, the Dutch team has a packed team. Three Dutch women racing the course. Of course, the world champion, as you mentioned, van Vleuten. So it will be interesting to see how they get on. Of course, I think you were mentioning before, Ian, that none of those riders are accomplished Zwifters. So it's going to be interesting to see how they race and how all these riders race coming into this race, because, you know, earlier in the year we had all these events happening, all these online races happening. Right now, this one is going to be interesting to see how everybody's racing and how serious these riders are going to approach this race as well. So when we're looking at favorites, that's something that I think we should take into consideration.
I can't see Annemiek van Vleuten or Anna van der Breggen like
well Ian, I was gonna say my pick is Annemiek van Vleuten.
She's won everything. She should be able to win the world championships in the e-world.
Yeah, absolutely. She's so strong, and where power to weight ratio is a major factor in these virtual races, I think it will make a big difference. But as you mentioned, neither van Vleuten or van der Breggen have a lot of experience racing on the Zwift platform, and there's an experience factor. There's certainly an experience factor, a lot of quirks, and I think one thing to mention is the power-ups. There will be the featherweight power-up, which can be used on climbs, and the aero helmet power-up, which can be used for attacks and also at the sprint finish. You know, you are not going to win a sprint on Zwift if you don't have an aero helmet power up to get your speed as high as possible coming into the finish line. So that level of experience and the in-game knowledge of how to use these power ups at the right time will certainly play a factor. And that's where I think the US team will have a major advantage. You know, they are coming in not only with strong riders, but also very experienced Zwifters, you know, being led by Lauren Stevens, who is the top female Zwifter in the world. I think won two stages of the virtual Tour de France. So, and a strong team as well, eight riders. So, yeah, Van der Breggen and Van Vleuten are gonna stand out as the big favorites as they always are. But yeah, that eight rider U.S. team with a lot of experience is it could potentially challenge them.
Shania Palace, Nielsen Sisters Racing for the U.S. team too. A quite packed team, both on the men's and women's side for the e-sports, e-bike world championships. Ian, who is your pick then for the women?
I'm going to go with Lauren Stevens. I mean, we have I don't think that this course necessarily suits her that well, but it'll be interesting to see the team dynamic play out if the U.S. team can make the race hard enough to get rid of some of the top sprinters, like the Dutch sprinter, Christian Wild, and then also contain Annemiek van Vleuten and Anna van der Breggen. There are a few other wild cards. Sarah Gigante, who is Lauren Stevens' teammate on Tibco SVP, just a phenomenal talent from Australia on incredible form. We saw her just a week or so ago win a national series race in Australia by like 7 minutes over her competitors. And then Tanya Irath, also the Zwift Academy winner from 2018. Oh, I did also want to mention, give a shout out to Christy Tracy from here in Austin, Texas. Not a professional road racer, but has made the U.S. team through the digital esports racing selection process, an incredibly accomplished virtual racer. So very cool that a woman who competes as an amateur here locally competes in road and gravel races locally, regionally, and does do national level racing is now competing on the world's biggest stage for the esports world championships.
It's cool that all these riders are coming together virtually online, and the U.S. have brought like 1,000 riders for the men's race, which includes Craddock as well. And then also on the men's side, we see a lot of these top guys like Campenaerts. We see Domenico Pozzovivo. I'm not sure if we've seen him before. I can't remember in some of those e-races earlier this spring. Harm van Hook from the Belgian team will be there with Victor Campenaerts. So U.S. team has quite a serious power lineup and what is a powerful stacked start list on the men's side.
Yeah, the name that sticks out to me on the U.S. team is Holden Kamo. I mean, another racer who literally never doesn't even ride on the road. His bike never leaves the trainer, but he does like 5 Zwift races per week, a ridiculously strong and a really good sprinter. So this race is going to probably come down to a group kick to the line, and it'll be interesting to see how his watts per kilogram stands up against these world tour riders, but also somebody who knows the ins and outs of the Zwift platform incredibly well. He was actually brought on as an advisor for the US-based, North America-based rally cycling team ahead of the virtual Tour de France, and helped the rally cycling team win a stage of the virtual Tour de France with Canadian Matteo Del Sin, who is also lining up for the Canadian team at the Virtual World Championship. So the Canadian team also looking strong, and I think an underdog for the win. You know, these virtual races can be very unpredictable.
Well, and some, you know, they're going to be facing also, we got guys, Jack Haig from the Australian team, Bozen Hagens there, Alberto Bettiol, and let's talk about these cross riders we mentioned before, Tom Pidcock and Eli Iserbeek. Those guys should be in for it because we're talking 50 kilometers. It's a short effort that these guys are used to. They're racing 1 hour efforts in these cross races. So, which brings me to my pick, Ian, and I'll do it again before you name yours. My pick is Iserbeek for the win here in the men's race.
Yeah, I like that, Gregor. That's a good take in terms of the power that is required to do well in the Zwift races is very similar to the level that Izerbit is putting out on the cross course. And we've certainly seen with Vanderpool, Venner, Izerbit and Pidcock, both accomplished road racers. Like, if you can compete at the top level of the elite men World Cup cross scene, you can compete at the top level of the World Tour, and certainly at the top level of these virtual races. I am going to stick with an American pick, Gregor, because I'm here to support the U.S. I'm going to go with a bit of an underdog. I'm going to go with Holden Kamoe. And the reason I'm going with this pick is something you mentioned earlier, is how seriously are these top World Tour racers to prepare for these virtual World Championships? I mean, these are guys that just came off of a very long season. I know Lawson himself took 2 weeks off the bike following the Giro d'Italia and the birth of his new child. He's back on the bike, he's training, and he's going to show up and give it the best that he can. But for someone like Holden, this is the moment he has been preparing his whole life for, at least his whole athletic life. This is probably, you know, by far the biggest athletic competition he will compete in. So he is going to show up very, very prepared and use his experience, and hopefully the U.S. team rallies around him there.